Abihail. I grew up to a family that were partially religious. My grandfather was a rabbi. And when I grew up, I was pretty much the black sheep of the family. Not to get into all the details, but apparently my father, that I knew as a father, he didn't believe or he didn't thought that I was his son. So I grew up with a father that was not actually a father figure. So life was not all that easy from the beginning. We moved a lot as a family because we had finance situations. And the more I grew up, I felt more rejected by my father, which led me to be very rebellious. I mean, yes, I knew the law. Yes, we celebrated the holidays and Shabbat according to the law. But I was very rebellious. I had problems at school. I have behavioral problems. So the more I grew up, it became more and more significant. Let me just state that pretty much at the age of 14, after an incident that we had in our family, my father and I, we had a dispute, and it came to the place that I almost killed him, literally. And that really shook me. And out of that day, he went out of the house. So my sister and my mother, we lived together. At around the age of 19, my father died. So when he died, I was in shock. I thought to myself, why did he die? I mean, I felt maybe we could have fixed things, but now he's dead. I can't do anything. You know, he's dead. You can't do nothing. From the age, I think, maybe 17 until 18, maybe 16 till 18, I was pretty much on the streets. We had what people are calling in the States, we had a gang, and I was a part of that gang. We slept on the streets, we used drugs, we broke into houses to get money. We were involved in crime, and it was also dangerous because we got involved with some dangerous people. Well, life was not easy, and it was not easy for me to understand why things happened the way they did. Maybe close to 19, I was out of the army. And around that time, because of finances, again, we lived together in a very, very small apartment. My mother, it's not even an apartment, it was a room in my grandmother's house. So you go through the newspaper and you mark at the ads that you think possibly that you might get accepted and work in something. But I was alcoholic. I really spent a lot of money that I did not have on alcohol. So I started looking for the job, as I said, and nobody would take me. And I thought to myself, what am I gonna do? I remember days and nights that I would spend and looking at the ceiling when I was lying in bed and asking, what am I gonna do? What's gonna happen with me? What am I gonna do? So eventually I marked up a news ad for a job. And they invited me to an interview. So I went to that interview. At that time, I had a nose ring and I had piercing all over my body. So the secretary got me into the office to meet with the owner of a furniture store. So we've had conversation. He asked me some questions. He liked me for some reason. So he sent me to the store. At that store worked a woman that was pregnant and she had to leave for, when somebody needs to take a vacation before they go and give labor. So I had to replace that woman. When I started talking with that lady, we've had an immediate connection. We talked about God, we talked about religion, and you know, things that are close to our Jewish nation. The interesting thing is that I didn't know that she was a believer. She dressed up like the rest of my family. I'm used to women with skirts and head covering. You know, it's normal for us. Apparently, she thought that I was better than the other guy. So they took me for the job. She trained me for about 2 weeks of time. And when she left, I was all by myself in the store. There were a lot of times that I felt lonely in that store because there were not a lot of customers sometimes, especially in the winter. So I used to call that lady. And we've talked about so many things. One day, winter, when it was rainy, I think it was 1996, maybe 1995. A religious man came into the store and persuaded me to buy the Zohar, which is a mystical books in Judaism. I didn't have money at the time, but I felt that after all the conversations that I have had with that lady, that I'm maybe getting closer to God, so maybe this is the way. So I bought those books. I called that lady and I told her what I've done, and she said, There was an awkward silence, and she asked me, would you like to hear something else? And I said, yeah, I'm open. So after a week, her husband and that lady, well, her husband took me to a meeting with a pastor in Ramat Gan, and he came to the part of Yeshua. Well, I felt a little bit awkward, but I kept on listening. And, you know, I honored this man. And at the end of the conversation, he asked me if I would like to have the New Testament. I said, sure, why not? So he gave me a New Testament for free, just a small book. And when I came home, it was so funny. I had those lots of books that I've bought for lots of money that I did not have, and one book that I got for free. So I thought to myself, I have a lot of spare time to kill at work. So I took one of those books and the New Testament. And I was reading the both of them, you know, alternating. And I was reading systematically from the New Testament, starting from the book of Matthew. The more I read the New Testament, the Gospels, I felt okay with what Yeshua was saying. He was saying good things about the kingdom and about keeping the commandments. And, you know, I felt good with the moral and the standards that I was setting. But whenever there was a time that he was referred as the Messiah, the Son of God, or something related to that issue, I felt a huge anti in my heart. That can't be. He is not the Messiah. He is not the Son of God. And I remember one time that I read the part where somebody asked Yeshua, what is the greatest commandment? And he said, love thy God with all of your heart, mind, and soul. And the second commandment, which is similar, is love thy neighbor or love your friend. And I was so angry with Yeshua. I was so angry. I thought to myself, who are you to say that the first commandment and the biggest commandment is love thy God? Who are you? Who are you to say those things? You're not one of us. I mean, come on. I was so angry. But I kept on reading. But the more I was reading, I felt confused. I was agreeing with what he was saying, but I did not agree with who he was. And at that time, I don't think I was believing that God did exist at all. So I started asking people what they think about the promises about the Messiah. I asked people from my family, asked people that came into the store. I just asked people, what do you think about the prophecy in Isaiah 7? Or what do you think about Isaiah 53? Or what do you think about Daniel and all those prophets who were prophesying about the Messiah? Or even Psalm chapter 2? Nobody was able to give me a straight answer. I felt that all the answers that people are giving me are just walk-arounds. They don't touch the point. I remember that I started praying. I don't exactly remember what I prayed, but I said, God, if you exist, and if there is any absolute truth in this world, I would like to know. I really would like to know what is the truth. So I was reading and reading the New Testament. It was mostly by myself. When I was 20, my birthday, 20th birthday, I came to the part in Romans, I think chapter 10, verse 9 and 10, where it says that whoever believes in his heart and confesses with his mouth will be saved. So you need to understand, I'm sitting in this office, in this store, all by myself. It's raining outside, nobody comes into the store. I'm reading this passage on my birthday, and all of a sudden, I put the book on the table and I said to myself, Yeshua is the Messiah, he is the Son of God. And I was absolutely shocked that I did it. I was shocked. And I had a smile on my face that I could not take off. And I felt really strange with it because I didn't smile a lot those days. And because it was a furniture store, you can understand there was a lot of mirrors. So I went to each and every mirror just to check that the smile was real. I was literally shocked that I said what I've said. I felt like a burden came out of me, like I had a stone, a huge stone that I carried with a big no on it, and I'm just taken off. It was easy to say that he's the Messiah, he's the Son of God. And I thought to myself, pretty much at that time, maybe I do believe in my heart. and I just didn't say it. And now it's time to say it. So I said it. And I felt very awkward by saying it, because it's not as if I was thinking about it and then I said it. It just came naturally. The feeling was, oh God, what have I done? why would I do this? It's as if something was built within me for all those weeks that I was reading the New Testament. But there was a conflict, because, you know, part of me was saying, no. And all of a sudden, somebody took over me and said, listen, leave the no aside, just say yes. I'll take it from here. And I think this is pretty much what happened. I mean, God helped. Without God's intervention, I wouldn't have been able to say yes. I felt freedom, I felt happiness, I felt like I can breathe, you know, air, clear air. I felt good. And you know, so immediately I called this lady named Rimona. She was so happy. I mean, she was shouting hallelujah over the phone. Her mother, who was not a believer, took the phone and said, God's gonna bless you so much for that decision. I was shocked. And she said, you have to come to a congregation. And I asked her, what is a congregation? I didn't know anything. It's a group of people coming together, believing in the same thing. And I didn't feel really ready for that. I didn't call my mother that day. I didn't tell her. I was not ready for this one. So I was invited to go to a congregation, but I did not went to a congregation. I felt that it was right for me to be on my own. And at that time I understood that the owner of the store, the boss that wanted to treat me as a son, he was a crooked man. And I did not feel comfortable with the new moral that I want to believe in to stay in that place. So I moved to Tel Aviv, living by myself with a friend and my cousin. It was just going wrong and wrong and wrong. Instead of getting better, it was getting worse and worse. And I thought to myself, what is going on here? I believe this is the truth. I'm trying to live the truth. I don't know how to pray. I don't know what to do. And every time I'm trying to do something that is right according to what I read, it just goes wrong. I mean, really, really wrong. I came to the place that I lost the other job that I've had. I didn't have money to pay the rent. I didn't have money to buy food. I was in bad relations with my cousin and with my friend that was living in the same apartment. I literally had no food for a few days, and I've decided that I will go fasting and praying. I didn't know exactly what it means, and it's not as if I had a choice. I mean, you don't have food, you fast. And I don't really remember what I did at that time, but I think I spent most of the time by myself, being closed in a room. I think on the fourth day, God reminded me the phone number of Rimona, the lady from the store. So I called her. She was not at home. Her mother told me that she lives elsewhere. So I called that place. She immediately recognized my voice. She asked me where I am, what I'm doing, and I told her about everything that I went through. And she said, listen, you have to come to a congregation. You just have to. And I thought to myself, I really have to. I think less than a week after that conversation that we've had, I went to a congregation, first time in my life. It was a prayer meeting during the week, not the main meeting. Very small place, family-like. And immediately when I came in through the door, I felt at home. It was almost like the same feeling when I said that Yeshua is the Messiah, the Son of God. It just felt cozy, felt good. I stayed in that congregation for about 8 years, going through a huge phase of transformation from the person that I used to be into something that God can actually work on later on. So this is pretty much the story. For someone that had not an easy life, to feel good is something. You notice it. I believe that Yeshua is alive. I believe that he's alive not because I read about it, but because I experience him being alive every day. And I surely will meet him one day. So I'm not ashamed to say that I want to be close as possible to Him in the kingdom of God when He comes back.